Hey, can we get the political rewind panel up here?
Are you all coming back?
Hey, everybody. Hi.
Hi.
My name is Bill Nygut. I'm the executive producer and host of Political Rewind. I think Peter Canfield. Is this the third or the fourth year we've done the show live here? I was trying to remember.
Third.
Every year for the last, I don't know how many of you have seen us do this show here before, but Peter and his committee have been really lovely in inviting us to come back and do the show every year. And we are very happy to be here. I just wanted to say hello. We actually go live at 2:06. So in a couple minutes yet, right now, back at our Midtown studios, they're playing the introduction to the show in which they are mentioning that we're here live, or I'm mentioning on tape, being live here with all of you today. Then we have an NPR news break, and we'll be starting right after that. So you all, I think you know Jim Galloway, AJC lead political reporter, columnist. Mary Margaret Oliver. We really wanted, we needed an attorney on this panel, so we got Mary Margaret. Mike Thurmond, CEO of DeKalb County. At least for the time being. And Loretta Lepore, who was Sonny Perdue's communications director back when Sonny was governor. And does a lot of work on transportation issues at the Capitol, and also was the co-chair of Carly Fiorina's presidential campaign in Georgia. So, Loretta Lepore. So, what do you got here? Oh my gosh, I wish I could pass this around. Jim Galloway just handed me a copy of the North Fulton Extra of the AJC, dated April 10th, 1980, with a photograph of Galloway looking like he's 14 years old. Ask him to show it to you after the show. And the column, what was the column?
It was on Weish Fowler's decision to run for the Senate.
Oh, okay.
And wow. How it wasn't all that stupid.
Wait, but that was 1980. Okay. Well, that's right. Fowler doesn't go until 84.
Okay, I'll have to read it.
Because McManigley won that 1980 race against Talbot.
Right.
All right. We are going to talk guns at the top of the show. There are some items about guns that are local in scope, others that are national. We have some news from Florida that we'll share. I have a microphone. If anybody here, as we have this part of the conversation, feels like you've got to get in the mix, just wave at me. We don't normally do audience participation, but if you really feel an urgency, give me a holler, and I'll wave at me, and I'll do my best. As long as we can get you to ask a brief question, okay? All right? We take two breaks during the show. They're being rolled in back on 14th Street. They're very short. We try to keep the breaks on this show very, very short so we have more time to talk. So I'm gonna throw it to breaks, but that's not a great time to like run around because we'll be back within 30 seconds. Okay, anybody want to ask a question of anybody before we start or say anything? All right, see you in a couple minutes. He was thinking about it.
I am a member of the Georgia State Bar. Last time I checked.
I didn't know that you were an attorney. I thought you were just a historian. No, seriously, are you a lawyer?
Let me check my bar card out. I was an attorney in the state of Georgia.
I've only known you for 30 years. Tell them about us.
Oh, yeah. Be a Nigut. No, I'll save it for when you're on there. Right. I'll save it for the entire state of Georgia. I'm not that guy that easy. I'm going to save that for the entire state.
Lane, should I be hearing our air? Because I don't. Okay. So who's going to cue? How am I going to get a cue? Thank you, Tom. Well, the only reason I wanted it was for to know when the news was over. But if you're going to cue me, I don't need it. Okay. Gardner, are you in the room?
Right over here.
There's one of our regulars. Former Congressman Buddy Darden. Any other political rewind panelists in the room? I didn't see anybody else. Oh, yeah, Caesar Mitchell just walked in. Yeah, potential panelists, too. Yeah. Hey, Caesar. 15 seconds and we're going to go on, everybody. Welcome to Political Rewind. I'm Bill Nigut. We're coming to you today live from the headquarters of the State Bar of Georgia in downtown Atlanta. We have an audience of, I'm not very good at numbers, but it looks like there may be 100 plus people in the room, journalists, attorneys, a handful of judges, I think, are with us today. This is the third year in a row that we've been invited to be part of this conference that takes place every year, the Bar Media Conference, which is a one-day gathering of journalists, attorneys, and judges to talk about the issues that they're all working on together. And we thank Peter Canfield, who organizes this conference for his 27th year this year, for inviting us again. We have with us today on this panel Loretta Lepore, a Republican consultant. She was Sonny Perdue's communications director when he was governor of Georgia. She also was the co-chair of Carly Fiorina's presidential campaign in Georgia. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you to the bar for having us today.
Yeah, I agree with that. We have Michael Thurmond. He is the CEO of DeKalb County, and he's not making the news, but news is being made about him. We'll talk about that a little later in the show. Michael, glad to have you with us.
Always delighted to be with you, Bill.
The Mary Margaret Oliver.
Discovered me in politics. Be a Nigut.
We have Representative Mary Margaret Oliver, who represents Decatur in the Georgia House. You're in this news about Mike Thurmond, too.
Stirring it up as much as I can.
always. And we have, of course, the lead political writer for the AJC, my partner on Mondays and Fridays on the show, Jim Galloway. Thanks for coming, Jim.
You're very welcome. Good afternoon.
Yeah, it's good to have everybody here. Okay, we have a couple of breaking news stories we want to get to. A little less than 2 hours before we came on the air, and Jim, this is a big deal. Florida Governor Rick Scott announced a package of gun reform measures for the state of Florida that include a blanket ban on the purchase of weapons for anyone under the age of 21. That doesn't talk about the particular weapon. No one apparently, if this legislation moves forward as he announced it, will be allowed to purchase a weapon unless they're 21 years old. That in itself, a major, major break from longstanding Republican attitudes about gun control.
Well, specifically the NRA. I mean, look, Florida is one of the, you think they've got a grip in Georgia, but they've got a stronger, the NRA has a much stronger grip in Florida. This is a state that even banned doctors from asking whether the pediatricians, I mean, asking kids whether there's a gun in the house and such. But the key to this, I think, is that we've heard President Trump say this, that, and the other about guns after the Parkland massacre last week. But it's always hard to figure out whether it's a little bit amorphous. Right now, we have the Florida legislature in session until March 19th. They're already drawing up legislation. If this passes, then I think it will mark a real shift.
Yeah, Mary Margaret, his proposal also includes a ban on bump stocks. You know, a lot of people are saying that on both sides of the aisle these days. He wants to add $50 million to the state budget for mental health initiatives and for new funding for trained school security officers. And what he doesn't do, though, is in any way propose restrictions on sales of particular weapons, assault weapons, semi-automatics, whatever. But here's what's interesting, and Jim sort of, I think, hinted at it. Here's what happens when a governor in a state that's just gone through this terrible tragedy has to face his own constituents in a much more compacted area. This isn't President Trump talking to a national audience. This is the governor looking at running for United States Senate, having to respond to the constituents in his own state, yes?
The teenagers who asked Senator Marco Rubio repeatedly, will you take money from the NRA, was the best example I've seen this week of an enormously active political change climate. When you have this kind of legislation coming out in Florida, and you have Mary Margaret Oliver and Donald Trump agreeing on bump stocks, then you have a different political climate. I was so encouraged this week with the 1,500 people that showed up on Liberty Plaza, all two-thirds of them in red t-shirts, Moms Demand Action. Stancil turned off the power and wouldn't allow them to have microphones. I'm a little bit on that soapbox this week.
He runs the Georgia Building Authority.
It's not his Liberty Plaza, though, the fact that he runs the Georgia Building Authority.
Right, I was just saying that's what his title is.
Yeah, his argument was that the group had not submitted an application.
I don't care what his argument is. That Liberty Plaza was built for people to come away from the Capitol, across the street, don't bother us on the Capitol, but those many hundreds of those women came into the Capitol and told me story after story about how their jaws were dropping at what their legislators were telling them, and it wasn't a good jaw drop moment.
Loretta, this is one state, and it is a governor who does, right now everybody thinks he's probably going to announce at some point his candidacy for the United States Senate. But is this, do you think, the beginning of some movement that could catch on? Jim Galloway seems to think this might be the start of something.
Do you mean from a political perspective or from a ground
perspective? That there might be other states, that there might be momentum beyond the student movement that's going on right now to pass laws, if Congress isn't going to act in various states across the country.
I think there will be movement in other states. I think the one thing about Rick Scott, though he is a Republican, he has not been a lifetime politician. So he came from the business sector, has not been a go along to get along type of governor. He's been fairly autonomous and charted new ground as a governor there. I think we're going to continue to, because he's proposed this package, and he's been very verbal throughout this crisis in Florida, taking on the FBI, and I think he'll continue to be vocal on this issue, that because he's putting this package forward, we're not going to see constituents, citizens, residents, the community that was most affected by this, go away, as in after previous types of shootings, right? So the bump stock issue that Mary Margaret's been talking about for quite some time should have been resolved after the Nevada incident.
Right.
And we had that kind of just went away. So I do think that there will be, where there are common sense, when we hear this term, common sense solutions, and what I mean by that are, you can be an individual, you can agree with the Second Amendment, but you can also agree that steps need to be taken to protect our children in this society. And that is, there are many things that have to come to the table.
Mike Thurmond, you know, one of the proposals, let's bring this to Georgia for a few minutes. But before we do, we should point out that Mary Margaret Oliver has been the sponsor of legislation to ban bump stocks here in Georgia.
And ban assault weapons.
And assault weapons as well. And as a Democratic member of the Georgia legislature, your expectation of getting this legislature to pass your measures is what?
Zero. But there's several other bills that are lower priority that can pass this session and that are actively being discussed.
Okay. Let me bring you in, if I may, Mike. So here in Georgia, first of all, we know that President Trump the other day said he thinks the solution, one of the solutions to this, is we should start arming teachers. Well, he says, no, not every teacher, but highly trained teachers, teachers who know how to use a weapon, and they've been around weapons. He cites ex-military people, veterans, who know how to use weapons. Here in Georgia, we have a gubernatorial candidate, Michael Williams, who thinks maybe some teachers ought to be armed. But there's also a proposal that he believes is correct, and also from Josh McCoon running for Secretary of State, saying that we need to have state patrols, armed security officers in every school. You've got a big county. You were the acting superintendent of DeKalb County Schools. What do you think?
And unfortunately, I experienced an active shooter incident in one of my elementary schools. It was the most frightening, heart-rending set of circumstances. And as we sped towards McNair Elementary School, all I could think was Sandy Hook. And what would I say to the 10, 20, 30, 50 parents whose children may have been killed in this particular incident? Thank God a lady named Antoinette Tuck literally talked the gentleman down after he fired. I think the political leaders, others, have to come to grips with the fact that the lives and the safety of our children has to be paramount. And scripture teaches us that eventually the children shall lead them. What really changed the atmosphere was those brave and brilliant and bright young people who articulated the real reality of being in an environment where their lives are at risk and adults failing to take affirmative steps to protect them. And historically, think about it. See my friend Andrew here. The Children's March in Montgomery. This is not the first time that children have played a key role in changing the tenor and the focus.
Yeah, let's tell our listeners you're pointing to Andrea Young, yes, who is the director of the ACLU here in Georgia. Go ahead.
And Martin Luther King and her father, Ambassador Young, children marched. And adults saw that children were being brutalized and harmed. The 16th Street bombing, where children died, played a key role in changing American attitude about segregation.
Do you think these young people are headed in that direction?
Absolutely.
Okay. Hey, Jim Galloway, let me bring you back into this thing. You know, you showed us a little bit of a column you started working on for Sunday's paper. Maybe we can talk about it. You can give us a preview later. But you start the column by talking about Jack Kingston.
Right.
Kingston was on our show on Wednesday. He has become one of the people, we've known him for many years, and yet the kind of turn he's made toward a much more what's the term that we use? He's sort of fallen into this category of people who choose to demonize the young people who want to take action.
He's become a professional Trump defender, yeah. I think it's fair to say, and right, he's among those who are questioning just the independence of these student voices. And basically what he's saying is that he thinks they're being co-opted by the likes of George Soros and George Clooney and other Georges, who knows. But of course we've had you know, the internet calling these people crisis actors.
Yeah.
And I think we had Gingrich Cushman on one of our previous shows just questioning, you know, why would you ever let your babes step in front of the camera
after this tragedy, speaking of the kids from the school who decided they wanted to speak out.
Right, and I would argue, and I do in the Sunday column, we don't have to go back to it, but once you've had a gun pointed in your face, that gives you a lot of credibility. And, you know, if you're in a state where an 18-year-old can buy an AR-15 and dream about killing his classmates, well, then maybe you're old enough to march on the streets to see if you can stop them.
Well, let's do something. We've got a live audience with us here. So let me do kind of an instant poll. And the nice thing is you're anonymous. Nobody knows who's clapping. But I'm curious. I'll close my eyes if you want. How many of you in this room, and clap on this one, agree with President Trump that one of the ways to fight these terrible, terrible acts of violence in schools is to arm some teachers in the schools? If you agree with that, I'd just like to hear a round of applause. Okay, we've got a smattering of applause. How many of you here think that we should have armed either Georgia State Patrol, as some proposals call for it, or armed security guards in every school in the state? Give us a hand on that. A little more. And how many think it's time we have some kind of either state ban or federal ban on certain weapon, you know, attack weapons? Thank you for that.
The polling data on assault weapons nationally and on Georgia is slightly in favor, somewhere between 50 to 60, depending on which poll. It's fascinating to me that the Florida legislators are seeing the reality of what the polls are telling them, and seeing that in the form of children who have been laying on the cement or in a closet as the bullets went over their head is significantly impact. I always remind my colleagues of Antoinette Tull, who is up a short movie this week, is up for an Oscar on the incident of her 45-minute live discussion with the shooter, who was a former Georgia foster care child. That story, what we avoided in Georgia, is what played out. The mood of the Georgia General Assembly on day 26 is kind of where we're all mad at everybody. And we're looking at what might happen, and there's kind of fights going on across the Capitol. I don't think the Georgia leadership yet understands that the mood is changing. I don't think they understand the 1,500 Moms Demand action on the Liberty Plaza. And I'm watching it on a day-to-day basis.
A couple things, Bill, if I could add this, is number one, a lot of this is simply an emphasis, prioritization. One of the things that really bothered me about this Parkland 4 shooting, of course, we all heard now about the sheriff's deputy who just kind of hung outside. Well, to me, the most significant fact there was he was a 32-year veteran of the department. And that tells me that was his retirement job. He was out to pasture. This was not. You weren't putting a strapping 28-year-old fellow who might have charged.
We heard from people at the school who said we never saw him.
Well, but you know, and I thought about it, but his training would tell him if he has a sidearm going up against an AR-15, See, and that's the reality. That's why these assault rifles have to be banned. You can't arm
All right, let me. I want to get you into this mix. We're gonna have to get a break, but I want you to get a chance before I do. But here's the thing: we've been getting on Twitter this week has exploded over this issue. In people who follow politics, GPB, people are angry. They say, but no, they're angry with us. They say, gee, you haven't really discussed what can be done. Why don't you come up with some proposals? Well, it's not our job to come up with proposals. But I think there's a point made by the critics, which is we have these kind of broad general conversations, Loretta, but what do we need to do? What should the Georgia legislature be doing? You're a Republican, you have worked with conservative Republicans. What do you think the Georgia General Assembly ought to do, say, in the next year to deal with these issues?
Well, I think that the Georgia General Assembly needs to hear from its constituents. And right now they're hearing from audiences and people who favor what they've done thus far, the majority, right? We have a Republican governor, we have two chambers controlled by Republicans, we have a lot of NRA members within the legislature. And we're about to see on March 14th an inordinate number of mothers take their children out of school and protest at schools across not only this city, but across the country. And that is going to be a public showing of what is going on in this community, because I've said this before, I live in a House district that is always voted over the last several presidential cycles 60% Republican. Yet if you go door to door, as I did when I ran for office, almost, and these were registered high propensity Republican voters, all said to me, Loretta, we've gone too far with our gun laws.
Okay, but then what are you going to do?
If I could jump in here, I think Rick Scott is throwing down the gauntlet.
That's what exactly. That's why that may be a very significant.
I think you've got a race for governor going on, and we don't know what I would kind of say it's going to be hard for Democrats to win. But number one, they've got that issue on their side. And you've got to see if somebody like Casey Cagle, certainly not Brian Kemp,
we have a lot of districts in this state, in this cycle, that are going to be contested. We haven't had that in a number of years, where we have a lot of races where you have long-term Republicans, where the demographics within those districts have shifted and could potentially go to the Democrats.
So you could see, Mike, I hear Loretta saying it could come down to, in legislative districts, some candidates embracing restrictions, maybe on assault weapons, whatever, but the candidates for governor aren't going to go there. How are we going to accomplish anything?
Well, I was interested in the fact, and listening to you, the applause as a result of your Insta poll, this is not a room full 100% Democrats.
That's probably true.
There were Republicans that I would assume who were applauding regarding the banning of assault weapons. That's important. The change will have to occur on the right. To Rick Scott, to others, it's what we've seen with transportation in Metro Atlanta. Republicans changed the dialogue on mass transit. Democrats have been there for decades. But when Brandon Beach and to some extent the speaker changed, then we were able to make progress.
All right, we need to get a break here, but this is too important a conversation. Mary Margaret, is that change coming?
The change has to come, and I think this election year, setting aside of the gubernatorial campaign on the ground, where there will be contested inside the outer perimeter, if that makes sense, I think people are upset. I think they are focused. There are several bills in the House at this point, House and Senate, that are practical, on-the-ground solutions to reduce gun violence. Close the gap of domestic violence violators who are barred from getting guns. Georgia has that bill that's pending, and as we know, domestic violence kills more women than anything else. There's a bill about straw selling your gun. If I know you're a felon, I give you my gun, that makes me a felon. There's the mental health purging of Georgia's mental health records every 5 years that then takes, and Vernon Keenan, one of my favorite public servants, having GBIs, carrying around a list, he and I are working on this list, there are 2,000 people that are taken off the list that will prevent you from getting a gun every year based on Georgia, only state of 50, purging mental health.
Every five years.
We are not doing the small, meaningful things.
All right. I apologize for interrupting. I've got to get a break in. There's a little more we can talk about on this, but we have a lot more to discuss here on Political Rewind, live from the State Bar of Georgia in downtown Atlanta. We'll be back in just a minute. Okay, thank you. Tom, I need to be able to see. Okay, I couldn't see you. All right, here we go. Welcome back to Political Rewind. I'm Bill Knight and Mary Margaret Oliver, continuing the discussion about guns with Loretta Lepore, also on the panel, Mike Thurmond, and Jim Galloway. I want to say one quick thing, Jim. You weren't on the show the other day when Kingston was on. I got some of the most poisonous tweets and emails I've ever had with people who were so angry we gave Kingston a chance to talk. And I think it tells us a lot about just how polarized things are. At the same, and I want to make one quick point about that. Political Rewind has always been about giving different voices an opportunity to speak out. That's an important thing. It's not up to me to judge who's right and who's wrong. But I will say that we have also, over the years, and you know this, not invited back people who cross a line in terms of their hate speech, their rhetoric that's not productive. And I have to say, I know Jack went a little too far the other day.
Our overarching rule is that you have to leave the talking points outside the speech.
That's exactly right. All right. You know, okay, this is important for me to say to the listening audience and to those of you who are here. Mike Thurmond and Mary Margaret Oliver were invited to do this show a week ago. So they've been on the calendar for a while now. They were not invited today because both of them are in the news. So that said, Mike Thurmond, well, maybe I better have you explain it. I don't think we want Thurmond to explain what he's going through.
All right. We have two of the major players in one of the kind of one of the instant dramas that's occurring at the Capitol right now. On Tuesday, you had HB 961, a bill to eliminate the CEO form of government in DeKalb County, introduced by State Representative Megan Hansen
of Brookhaven.
And by her side at a surprise committee hearing, which resulted in an instant passage, was DeKalb County Commissioner Nancy Jester, one of the few Republicans on the list. She represents North DeKalb. And so we have Ms. Oliver was on the committee, at the Governmental Affairs Committee that heard it. She raised her objections. I think Mr. Thurmond didn't know about it until I called him.
Okay. So before we get to YouTube talking, Mary Margaret and Mike, Loretta, we should point out that this measure bypassed what would be the normal order of the day. This is local legislation, typically. It should typically have gone to the DeKalb delegation for them to vet it before it was presented to the entire General Assembly. But the sponsors of the bill, they know the DeKalb delegation is an all-Democratic delegation, basically, and wasn't gonna get anywhere, right? So they greased the wheels for it.
Well, yes, I think they even indicated that there was an agreement amongst the delegation, and that's why they were pursuing it in this fashion. And I think there were members of the committee, not only Democrats, but Republicans on the committee, that raised some questions about the way that this was brought forward and how this was being handled. And we don't see it just in DeKalb. We kind of see this kind of consternation in some of the other local delegations too. And so typically, you know, this is a generalization, but typically when bills come forward this way, they don't end up being very successful.
Okay, but okay, so, but it's there. Mary Margaret, to make sure that we understand why this is a bigger issue than just the fact you and Mike are on the show today, tell us what is behind this kind of measure and why people around the state might think about why this matters.
I'm sitting in the committee chair, not bothering anybody about anybody's business. And a bill that is not on the agenda was introduced 24 hours before, has not been through a subcommittee. A copy of the bill is not in the folder, is brought for a vote in front of the committee.
That affects 800,000.
That affects 800,000 people. And what I said in the committee and what I say today and to anybody who will listen to me, this is exactly the kind of thing that irritates the voters. It was a partisan stunt for some kind of political statement that will achieve nothing other than making people mad. If you get up in the morning and go to politics in order to make people mad, you're not serving people. This has no realistic ability in my judgment, in part because Mike Thurmond is personally popular and doing a okay job in a tough spot. Rephrase that. Mike Thurmond is doing a really good job. Excuse me. It's something that just irritates people. And my question, Megan Hansen comes from a swing district in Brookhaven. I represent part of Brookhaven. Does that make her look powerful and smart in front of her constituents? Or does it just make her look like a games person?
So Mike, Mary Margaret says your job is safe. But what are these enemies out to get you all about? And by the way, we'll give Megan Hansen a chance to talk about this should she choose to come on the show. But go ahead.
I know Megan. I don't consider her to be an enemy. My concern is the negative impact it's going to have on the overall atmosphere of our county. We know the challenges that DeKalb has faced over the last 20 years. The biggest challenge I face, and the one we're beginning to address, is the bridge divide between North and South, black and white, rich and poor, Republican and Democrat. I believe that this bill was designed to as a wedge issue, is what Representative Oliver said, to create dissension and divisiveness throughout our county. When I think about issues like this, and I was telling someone, this is similar to what the Russians attempted to do in November 2016. These are the type of issues, the tweets, the posts, the disinformation, designed for one thing only, which is to undermine the credibility and trust of the government and the people who served in it.
Loretta, Mike talked North and South DeKalb, black and white. How much of this do we fear is driven by race? We got an African American CEO, and unfortunately, you've got two legislators who happen to be white who pushed this thing. Am I going too far to assume that there's some racial implication here?
You know, I can't really answer that question. I mean, I know Megan's district. I think she won a special election in a district that was previously held by a Democrat. It's been going back and forth between Republican and Democrat the last couple of cycles. This is not a hardcore Republican district. The motivation behind this bill, I couldn't even begin to guess as to why these legislators came forward with it and why they did it in this fashion.
Let me speak to the race issue. Excuse me, Jim. I carried every precinct in Representative Hansen's district. I carried every precinct in Commissioner Justice district. North and South, East and West, the most conservative district. We got 81% of the vote. This is an attempt to undermine what I believe is our successful efforts to build bridges, to open up the lines of communication and progress.
Jim, I'd be relieved to learn that this doesn't seem to be.
Here's the thing. Number one, in Jester's and in Henson's defense, what the reason that they put forward for at the committee hearing for doing this was that DeKalb does have it has a pretty tough record when it comes to ethical issues, and they were pointing a hand at the strong CEO, which essentially you've got a strong mayor form of government in DeKalb County as a whole. But that being said, I mean, Mike's point is that even if this goes through, even if there is a shift in how DeKalb County is governed, you go from a chairmanship who presides over a commission, which then hires out to a county manager, which is what they're pushing for, then you're still going to have Michael Thurmond as chairman of the DeKalb County Commission.
Right. Mayor Margaret, you want to get a last word in before we move on to another issue?
The bill is legally ineffective on several different levels. It can't, you can't abolish the CEO without a referendum in DeKalb County. I think people out there are caring about real issues. Maybe they're caring a lot about gun violence this week. But this kind of gamesmanship, this kind of something that looks petty to a lot of people, doesn't help us. Mike says it doesn't help DeKalb. It doesn't help anybody.
Okay, let's do this. Let's get our final break of the show out of the way. When we come back, there are a couple of other issues in the legislature right now, one of which we have not talked about at all, Jim, and this is a good day to do it. And that's the hidden predator bill that is now bubbling up at the General Assembly. This is Political Rewind, live in front of an audience of attorneys, judges, and journalists at the State Bar in downtown Atlanta. We'll be right back. Everybody doing okay? We got another 15 plus minutes, and then you can go drink a Coke. Everybody okay? All right, 10 seconds, gotcha. Standing by. Welcome back to Political Rewind. Jim Galloway, Mary Margaret Oliver, Loretta Lepore, and Michael Thurmond all on the panel today. Jim, a measure that has not gotten an enormous amount of attention, and we haven't talked about it on the show, so this is a good time to do it. What's called a hidden predator measure, introduced by Representative Jason Spencer.
Of Woodbine, Republican.
Right. And essentially what this bill, among other things, is it adds the length of time that someone who has been the victim or alleges they've been the victim of a sexual predation, sexual abuse, has to come forward. I think it, Mary Margaret, goes from age 23 to 38.
38.
And Georgia, Jim, I think has the worst statute in the country, or one of the worst. No, Mary Margaret says no.
Well, in 2015, Jason Spencer, number one signer, and I was number two on it, was successful in expanding Georgia's statute limitation to allow more victims to bring actions for having been abused as a child. At that time, Georgia's action was pretty progressive in terms of the national scene, and there's been a great deal of discussion and research, and also cases brought that have brought the issue forward.
Okay, now the first thing, number one, I wish I could call, what's the name of the number of the bill, do you recall?
605.
605, okay. We are approaching crossover day on Wednesday, and so there's a deadline for this bill that has not cleared the House chamber yet. And what strikes me, Bill, that's happening that I haven't seen happen before is Jason Spencer and others calling out the larger organizations who would face more legal exposure if this bill were
passed. Well, that's,
and
yeah.
They include the Boy Scouts,
yep,
of America,
yep,
and the Catholic Church.
And Loretta Lepore, until the news started reporting on this, for reasons that make sense, those organizations have tried to do this, lobby on this, very, very quietly. They don't have any desire for the public to know they're fighting this measure.
Right, and for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
I mean, they have concerns. I mean, I think the church has tried to rectify within itself the issues that it has had over the years. I think the Boy Scouts have done the same. We also see the private sector worried about some liability issues.
Is it enough that these
the chamber is also weighed in on this?
Is it enough that these organizations are trying to do this on their own? Is this excessive legislation from your point of view?
You know, I haven't read the bill in full, but I would say that given where we are today with regard to the Me Too movement, and with the amount of time that it takes an individual to reconcile what has happened to them in their youth, later in their adult life, this doesn't happen on a given timetable, right? So to say 23, this is an individual that perhaps is just graduating college, just starting their life, not a time when they're going to necessarily be coming forward with certain allegations or of abuse that had happened to them early in their life. By 38, you're a more mature individual. I don't think in terms of the age limit that it's excessive.
I apologize. Mary Margaret, just to close this out, Jim Galloway points out, crossover day is rapidly approaching. What's your assessment of whether this measure is going to make it across the aisle?
I think it's a 51% chance it'll go across the aisle. The research that we heard in 2015 where three Republican political leaders had very high profile sex abuse cases in their districts, people coming to the Capitol with very real stories, gave us a strong basis for passing it in 2015. But research shows that when you're having your own children, those life-changing moments in your mid-30s of adulthood and children and families are frequently the incidents when these issues come forward to you in a very damaging way.
All right. We'll watch to see if that makes the crossover. By the way, we are going to be live at the Capitol next Wednesday for crossover day. If you can't hear us on the radio, you can always download, subscribe to our podcast to hear that show. But we'll be down there with members of the General Assembly coming in to tell us how things are moving on next Wednesday afternoon. Mike Thurmond, there's also a bill to ban using a cell phone. Holding it. Thank you. You got to have a speaker phone or something. Good idea. Does it make any difference?
Well, marginally, but yes, but the thing to understand, this is an election year, and our distinguished representatives all have their eyes on qualifying in the upcoming election season, and there is a rush to define oneself so that he or she might be able to get reelected
okay,
in
but,
the coming election
all right,
season. But to that point,
yeah.
I say I'm not opposed to it. The question is one of the enforcement, the cost of it, in terms of the value.
Jim, reasoning behind it seems pretty good. We're having a lot more traffic fatalities in Georgia.
Right, if you talk to John Carson, he's a state representative from North Carolina who's sponsoring this legislation, he will tell you that insurance rates are going up, not because the insurance rates are going up, they're going up because of more accidents, and the accidents are rear-enders.
How many of you in this audience, by applause, already use a handless or a speakerphone to talk on the telephone? All right. How many of you think it's a good idea that you should not be able to do that, that you have to have a speakerphone?
In my little newsletter, I have a very unscientific poll that 88% voted for passage of the distracted driving.
Loretta is...
Part of the justification for the legislation also is that several years ago, there was a no texting bill passed. And law enforcement is having a very difficult time enforcing that because you can't tell if somebody's sitting in their car texting or if they're making a phone call or getting ready to answer a phone call. So it hasn't been an enforceable piece of legislation. This is a much more obvious way for law enforcement to detect if somebody's on their phone in their car driving. And so as a mother of two teenagers or young people that are driving, I see far too many accidents because of handheld devices. Friends, family. I have a friend who was hit twice by teenagers texting and driving. So I think we have a real problem, and I think the attempt to resolve it deserves merit.
No.
But also, the same study showed that the display panels that are manufactured in the vehicles are more distracting than using the telephone.
Interesting.
So it's relative. And the question is, to Loretta's point, how do you enforce it?
You know, Galloway, there's a certain way, and Mary Margaret, you were there too, and I guess you were too, Mr. Thurmond. There's a certain way in which this reminds me of Thomas B. Murphy's fight against mandatory seatbelts. Same kind of arguments against it, right? It's not enforceable.
Which he never used, by the way.
Right.
And I will tell you, I think this one, like that one, is going to be solved by technology. Now, within 5 to 10 years, every vehicle is going to be equipped with cell phone connections.
Let not to mention autonomous cars, which is going to change our life patterns dramatically.
Is this going to pass?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Wow.
It's my prediction.
The Netflix tax is dead. Proposal to add a tax on the use of streaming services like Amazon, like Netflix, for people like me who, that's all we do with video is watch on streaming services these days. I guess that's good news, but Mary Margaret, this is an attempt to find some way to fund this high-speed internet expansion into rural Georgia. Excuse me. You know, the lieutenant governor today has a news release out saying high-speed internet delivered across all of Georgia, but if you read the news release, you still got to figure out a way to pay for this. It's really still a theory, isn't it?
The Rural Development Council has worked very hard. Their proposals, a couple of which we passed this week, about giving extra tax breaks to railroads, shortening railroads, and the tax credit for hospitals, neither of those proposals are super high priorities in terms of potential of helping people. But broadband is an issue that really matters out there in rural Georgia. And I think that the federal legislation, the federal attention, hopefully the infrastructure money, coming from Washington will help. This is a significant issue.
Yeah, the Trump budget, should this get through, and we know it's only his thinking, but it does provide, I can't remember what the figure is. It's only about $40 or $50 million, I think, for expansion.
It's a little bit more higher than that. The point is that it's a 4-to-1 match. You know, the state would still have to be ponying up money. There is an initiative, a Steve Gooch initiative in the Senate, that would allow the DOT to put broadband cable, working with a private company. In partnership along interstate highways.
Right, points, right. So there were three bills passed in the Senate, out of Senate, the Regulated Industries Committee this week that all deal with expansion of rural broadband. And so you have at the table cities and counties, you have at the table EMCs, the DOT, the cable companies, and the telecom companies, all trying to figure this out. And there's been a lot of discussion on this, starting last summer, going all the way through the fall. There's a whole different host of fees that each, you know, the various industries pays. There's been a lot of back and forth. I will say that Senator Steve Gooch has managed to navigate this and thread the needle with most of these groups that in the past have been pretty put stakes in the ground, and they are coming together because they recognize that there is a earnest need in the state to reach those unserved and underserved communities throughout the state that then provide healthcare through telehealth or whatever, and allow businesses and economic development to flourish in areas that are underserved.
But again, Mary Margaret, this sounds like one of those issues like transit, which takes a long time to make its way into the brains of your colleagues. In other words, they support the notion of rural broadband, but
I think something will happen with broadband this year.
What does that mean?
It's too high a profile, too much of a reality of how much rural Georgia needs this.
So these bills provide the infrastructure, right? They provide the pathway for the infrastructure to be laid. And the DOT has already put out an RFQ to begin this process that if these bills pass, would begin next year. This is unlike transit, right? This can happen very quickly. There are poles out there. There are lines out there. The DOT has the ability to do this statutorily. This infrastructure can go in very quickly.
What will that mean?
And one reason why it's likely to happen, I think it will happen, is because Metro Atlanta wants that transit package.
Yeah.
And if they're going to get that transit package, there's going to have to be a trade made.
Jim, for our many listeners who are not in Metro but are across the state, what will rural broadband mean for them?
Well, this is the foundational. If you're going, rural Georgia, especially in South Georgia, is a depopulated area. It's a hard area to support in terms of market for broadband. But it's also the basis of providing cheap medicine, providing schools with say AP courses that they can't hire teachers for, but maybe they could link into offices in Atlanta. And it lets you start businesses from anywhere in the state.
All right, I want to take up one last thing. We don't have a lot of time, but you, Jim, on the, I should have said, that we read you on Wednesdays and Sundays in the Dead Tree edition of the paper, but you're posting on the Political Insider blog, part of Politically Georgia, all the time. And one of the things that you, and I think Tamar Hellerman and Bluestein, who's here somewhere, posted about was this: we're no longer a nation of immigrants.
Right. Right, there was a piece of the Times today that said that the federal agency that issues green cards has removed the phrase "a nation of immigrants" from its description of the U.S. With that, I think in the morning jolt, I think I kind of put a few paragraphs from Tamar Hellerman there, which basically kind of spotlighted Sonny Perdue. He's in an interesting position. David Perdue has formed a partnership with Donald Trump and Tom Cotton of Arkansas to cut immigration in half. And yet, Sonny Perdue, as Secretary of Agriculture, is still out there pitching the farmer point of view, in which is we need these people coming in on a temporary basis to pick vegetables, to harvest blueberries, etc.
Mike, I'm going to give you just a minute on this, but before I do, and as part of this, the president today spoke at CPAC. It was a throwback to the Trump campaign rallies of 2016. He did it again. He went after undocumented immigrants, talked about them as murderers, as rapists, as crooks in every way. So, you know, this does make you have second thoughts about where are we going as a nation of immigrants?
Well, it's disgraceful, really, and it's a rear guard action that has no force in fact. Let me tell you, for those who make the argument, being a former school superintendent, 26% of my 102,000 students came from homes where English is spoken as a second language. In DeKalb County, the only two demographic groups that are growing are Hispanic, Latino, and Asian. You can build a wall, but you can wall them in because they're already here. You will not wall anybody out. And we need to be about a nation that embraces the diversity and began to embrace the future. It's politically potent, but it is basically a non-starter in terms of the future direction.
All right, we have a couple of seconds. Thank you. What are you hoping to get done before crossover day? What are you personally most concerned about? You got about 30 seconds to give us that.
The good gun bills have to pass for us to have any credibility with our constituents. A. B. The Hidden Predator Act needs to go forward at least for a discussion in the Senate. Three. The state budget that's coming forward with $58 million for the first time of new funding for children's mental health has to remain intact.
All right, Mary Margaret Oliver, you've got quite an agenda. What are you looking at? You're down there lobbying. You've got 30 seconds. Tell us what you're working at.
So I really have been following the broadband, the Rural Broadband Initiative, as well as the transit piece.
Mike, do you have anything that DeKalb County is looking at?
Well, we'll focus on the CEO bill. We got to get to it. No, actually, my focus is on Stone Mountain. We will be in the next, as we approach the 50th observance of the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King, we want to redefine Stone Mountain as a place of brotherhood and peace and disavow the history of Klan and racism. We believe that part belongs to all Georgia.
Yeah, the question though, of course, Jim, we've all watched it as closely as what do you do, especially to honor, say, Dr. King. We know the bell tower on top of the mountain didn't go very far.
We haven't given up on that one yet.
We haven't, Jim? Yeah. Jim's been very
expanding
active.
There, you subtract by addition. That 3,000 acres, the park is big enough to tell a broader story of all Southerners and the role they played in building this great nation.
We will, by the way though, we now have, is it the legislature, actually passed, was it in the legislature? We've changed the name of that little trickle of water in Savannah from Runaway Negro Creek.
But we won't have a hearing on Southern Monuments.
Yeah, all right, that's it. We are completely out of time for today's show. Jim Galloway, Mary Margaret Oliver, Mike Thurmond, is this okay to talk to you in the audience today? All right, so again, we are have had a great time with the, for the third year in a row, with the people who are here for the Bar Media Conference, and we appreciate your wanting to come in and watch us put this show together. So my thanks to you for being here. For those who listen to us on Mondays and Wednesdays, and even if you don't, if you can, you want to subscribe to our podcast, we will be back on Monday looking at what happened over the weekend and keeping you up on all of that news. And then on Wednesday, we're live from the state capitol on crossover day. So thank you all for being with us.
Can you work out some CLE credits for me while I'm
on the stage? All right. That's it. Goodbye, everybody. Have a good weekend.
Huh? I actually work for the state bar. I'm in the communications department, so I'll write an article and post photos and all that kind of stuff for this event.
Well, I do like